Thank you so much to the conference organizers for inviting me to this symposium. It's a great pleasure for me to speak at this symposium and at the Salk Institute. I'm very happy to share our work with you, but particularly I will be working about the program which was started by two amazing scientists, Dmitry Belyaev and Lyudmila Trut. It's at the Institute of Cytology and Genetics of the Russian Academy of Sciences in 1959. Dmitry Belyaev was an evolutionary geneticist who was thinking a lot about animal domestication, and Dr. Trut was so fascinated about his ideas that she moved to work with him to Siberia from Moscow University. At that time, there was a lot of debates about what was the first during animal domestication. Is it was selection for morphological traits, or it was selection for production, or domesticated animals are actually results of hybridization of different species. And Dmitry Belyaev argued strongly that selection for behavior was the first and the most important thing during animal domestication. And the experiment which he set up kind of formed our genetically centered view of animal domestication. So to test his hypothesis that selection was so important for animal domestication, he decided to choose the species silver fox, which is a coat color variant of the red fox, which was bred in captivity at that time for about 50 years, but have never been domesticated. The farm foxes, they usually show a fearful and aggressive response to humans, even then that they were bred at captivity since late 19th century. Dr. Trut and Dmitry Belyaev visited multiple farms across the former Soviet Union and selected several hundred of animals who became founders of the future tame strain. So first, we tried to select animals who show less fearful and aggressive response to humans, and then they started to select for foxes who actually showed the willingness to interact with the humans. It's amazing that selection was very fast. In less than six generations of selection, we started to see few individuals who actually was wagging their tails when we see humans. And then what was also amazing thing which we did in this, during the selection process, we tried to avoid inbreeding in this population. That allowed to have an ongoing selection for behavior in this population for many, many years. So by 2002, the percent of individuals in their population was about 71% who we called allied. So these animals are just extremely friendly. They, you know, all what they want is basically to interact with humans. And I will show the video just in a couple of minutes. And basically all foxes, tame foxes in the tame strain are tame, but we still have some gradations for them. Some of them more tame, some of them a little bit less tame. We also needed to have some control population for their studies because we did a lot of behavioral observations, a lot of physiological studies, and to have more or less kind of homogenized group of animals whom we can study as a control, we started selection of foxes for aggressive behavior in 1970. And in this case, it was a critical distance between the experimenter and the caged animal when animals start to show the aggressive response to humans, which count, and of course the intensity of this aggressive response. So now I want to show you the videos of. From two populations. I don't need to explain in which case we have tame animal, in which case we have aggressive animal. So this is a kind of an example of just a standard test which we are using to test behavior of these foxes. It has four steps. Each is 1 minute long. Here's a little bit shorter version of that. And all these tests are videotaped. So you can see how different their location in the cages, postures they have, sounds they make. Yeah. So you can see that the tame fox wants just to continue to interact, while aggressive fox is just saying, go away, and it's happy to be without humans. What is amazing about these behaviors, you can see how different they are, but what is really amazing is that they are genetically determined. We made a lot of different experiments, like cross-fostering of pups between tame and aggressive moms, even transplantation of embryos, and of course breeding between tame and aggressive animals, which strongly confirmed that these behaviors have very strong genetic component. And that altogether gave us results of a very interesting experiment, the domesticated fox, but also the model for genetic studies. And that's we started to collaborate with the Dr. Truth group on studying the genetic basis of these behavioral differences between tame and aggressive strains. There are several amazing things about these strains which really helps genetic research. First of all, which were bred separately for many, many generations, but they are outbred. So that means that if you will do the crosses, we can actually have, afterwards, we have an opportunity for very high resolution mapping of behavior, not only have very long fragments of the chromosomes where it will be extremely difficult to identify the genes which causes has effect on behavior. It's also very important that these foxes are living under standard conditions, and we have an opportunity to test their behavior at precise time points, and we have very similar experience of interaction with humans, so which is always not the case with the dogs. So to do genetic studies, to actually to understand what was the genes for which Belyaev and Truth were selecting these foxes for so many generations, we set up experimental pedigrees where we bred aggressive to tame fox in multiple individuals in a reciprocal manner, that mom can be aggressive and dad would be tame fox and vice versa. We produced F1 individuals, and then we bred them back to tame strain, when we bred them back to aggressive strain to produce backcross populations, and also we bred them to each other to produce F2 type of population, almost like Drosophila genetics. And then we analyzed behavior in all these crosses exactly the same way as I just shown you on the video. We tested behavior of each individual in this population multiple times. We had a better situation than Dr. Truth 40 years ago. We have video cameras, so we could record all their behavior and then analyzed that behavior with a set of traits from video records. Then we did principal component analysis and came up with measurable behaviors for each individual in these populations. And on this figure, you can see how different behaviors of aggressive animals from tame animals F1 is kind of show behavior intermediate between aggressive and tame individuals, backcross to aggressive very close to aggressive population, backcross to tame very close to tame, and we have also F2, which is a little bit more aggressive based on the principal component 1 than F1 population. So what these figures show us that this behavior is highly heritable. It's a very strict heritable pattern of behavior, and that is a kind of great trait to try to map to in genetic studies to try to identify the underlying genes. So we genotyped our pedigrees with dog-derived microsatellite markers because we didn't have any special resources for the fox. And we identified about 10 significant QTLs, which we call the quantitative trait loci, the regions in the genome, which most likely have signals of selection, which have effect on behavior. And particularly was interesting fox chromosome 12, where we identified at least 2 loci which have a strong effect on behavior in these foxes. So now when we have this loci, what is our next step? Of course, we want to identify genes and pathways which are involved in behavior. But what was also very interesting, when we looked at compared the region which we identified in the fox, this region overlaps with the most significant region which Dr. Wayne group found, which differentiate dogs from wolves. But in the research which was done by Dr. Wayne, we don't really know what was that region is responsible for. It differentiates dogs from wolves, but we don't know if it actually has any behavioral importance or not. And It was quite amazing that the most significant, our most significant loci was overlapped with the dog loci. Of course, we do not expect that it will be the same mutation, and we do not really think that it always will be the same genes which are the same between dogs and foxes which are involved in friendly behavior or aggressive behavior, but we expect that the pathways probably will be to much extent the same. And to be able to get inside of these pathways, we can do a lot of different studies these days. Because now, finally, we have the genome of the fox. The complete genome was sequenced and assembled at BGI Genomic Institute, and now we're working with this genome. We have huge pedigrees which segregate behavior in these foxes, so we can study genetic architecture of these behaviors and to use the whole genome sequence and the single nucleotide polymorphisms map to actually finally have good genetic markers. We can do selective sweep mapping within these tame and aggressive populations to identify the regions of increased homozygosity in their genomes and to reduce our QTL intervals. We can do RNA-seq analysis to identify these pathways, and we can do imaging studies, which we started to do in collaboration with Dr. Irene Hoecht and Todd Prius at Emory University. So these folks, I just want to demonstrate that these folks actually is kind of such a deep resource which can give us an information about systems which are involved in regulation of behavior, which is not so easily available in many other systems. And by synergism with the dog studies, we can actually see if it is universal or not, with these mechanisms are universal or not involved in domestication and regulation of behavior. But while I still have a few minutes, I want to say about some other features of these foxes. What is interesting that they were selected for pretty standard conditions, like for example, how fox would behave to humans than human in approaching the fox cage, it appeared that they as skillful as the dog puppies in solving some tricks, and especially understanding the human pointing cues. So the Brian Hara visited the farm in Novosibirsk and he set up the pretty easy experiment where you pointing to helping to understand the fox where the food is and in this bowl or another bowl when fox cannot see in which bowl the food is. And it appeared that the tame foxes understand this test very well, while foxes from standard farm bred population don't do it very well. So we think that, of course, that because if tame foxes are so comfortable with humans, that maybe help them. But with farm bred foxes were also socialized very, very well. But still, we just didn't do as well in this test. As it was mentioned before, the socialization period was changed in the tame foxes. The tame foxes do not have that spike of the rise of the cortisol, which foxes from conventional population do have, or for example, wolves have and dogs do not have, which kind of indicates the closure of the socialization period. The tame foxes have this socialization period open for a long time, and that's actually very, very difficult to scare them with something. They are very resilient to any stress conditions, so it can really help them to learn way more about the environment than individuals who have early closed socialization window. It also was interesting that when we started the experiment, we saw a lot of changes in also in morphology, in appearance, like for example with star phenotype, in physiology and in development. We don't really like physiological changes would include several things. First of all, it would be different levels of glucocorticoid, but also some reproduction changes. Some foxes got the opportunity to be reproduced twice per year, in difference from the usual foxes, which can reproduce only once. Later on, all these features were almost lost from this population, but we never really selected for these features of these animals. We selected continuous selection solely for behavior. But what is interesting, when this star phenotype is still present in the population, and when we set up our experimental crosses, we still have some animals which have a star phenotype in these crosses, and we don't really see any segregation between this star phenotype and behavior. So that kind of brings us to the question, what was the mechanisms of this co-inheritance of different traits? It was pleiotropy, selection for behavior was actually leading to changes, to selection for some genes which have effect on multiple traits. It was genetic drift, because it was closed populations, some regions were fixed just in random. Or it was a hitchhiking, and closely we were selecting for regions on the chromosomes which had several closely linked genes. And our data so far kind of is more in support of the late hypothesis that this particular perhaps was a hitchhiking, and then when the animals were going through several generations of selection, the recombination event in this population accumulated, and these strong bonds between different genes were breaked. So in the end, I just would like to summarize a little bit what Fox experiment provides us with. And first of all, I think one of the most important things is that it's really helped to form the genetically centered view of animal domestication. Second, it's shown that selection, very strong selection for something, can actually lead to some other changes. And if we would decide, for example, to select foxes for very reproductive abilities, so we decided that foxes who can reproduce twice per year are better by some reasons than foxes which reproduce once per year, we perhaps could have that opportunity to do if we would kind of follow on that. So that's maybe the way how selection of dogs for behavior also worked. And first of all, which we I and my collaborators are particularly excited, of course, because we're using it in our work, is that they provided us with an excellent model, which have very deep potential to understand the genetic regulation, and not maybe even genetic regulation of different behaviors. So in the end, I would like to thank my collaborators. This is Dr. Ludmila Trout. This is Greg Eklund, who was my long-term advisor at Cornell. This is Dr. Gordon Lark from the University of Utah, who is an expert in genetics of quantitative traits in canids. This is now my lab at University of Illinois, and these people did a lot of molecular work with this study. And of course, I'm very grateful for support for this research. Thank you.